The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of KSMQ Public Service Media Incorporated or its assigns.
Thank you for joining us on Farm Connections. I'm Dan Hoffman, and I'm pleased to introduce our local farmer, Mr. Jim Chekel. Jim's going to talk tonight about the use of ag products and how the international community is building a more sustainable future. If you have questions, you certainly can email the station or go to the website, ksmq.org. Jim, tell us a little bit about your farm operation in Dodge County.
I just farm a small farm that's located between Caston and Dodge Center. I raise 75 acres of corn and 75 acres of beans. In addition to that, I work an off-site job at Mayo Clinic, and then I'm the Dodge County Farm Bureau President and involved with several other groups too.
In addition to all of those things, Jim, if I remember right, you also do some retail work.
Yes, that's true. I also work at a furniture store down in Rochester.
And before that, an ag power group.
Yep. Yes.
So I know you're busy, but you took time off to do something called See for Yourself, sponsored by the United Soybean Board. So tell us about See for Yourself. What did that mean and where did you go?
Okay, the United Soybean Board took a program, an idea from the Minnesota soybean growers. The Minnesota soybean growers knew that a lot of people, when you say to them, where do your soybeans go? Most farmers say the local elevator. And where do they go after that? Most people don't know. So the Minnesota soybean growers looked at the markets and where the soybeans were going and started a program where they took people and took them to see ships being loaded in Washington or processing facilities and in different states. And the United Soybean Board looked at the program and said, this is a great idea. So they then took the program and made it a national program in which they select one person from 10 different states and take them to a foreign country to look at international marketing.
Excellent. And so being on the show, you're taking your experience, which most of us haven't had, and you're sharing with the audience, which is very, very, very kind of you. Mm-hmm. How long were you in the Mexico area?
The entire trip was 7 days. The first day was touring around St. Louis, Missouri, and seeing some of the facilities that use soy and soy ink and soy diesel. And then it was 5 days in Guadalajara. And the state is Jalisco, so we actually landed in the city of Guadalajara and then traveled to farms that were in probably a 75 to 100 mile range of Guadalajara in the state of Jalisco.
And if we look at Mexico, Guadalajara is positioned where geographically?
If you go down along the west coast, the Mexico curves and the Baja Peninsula comes down along the side. If you go in about 100 miles from where that curve point in the Baja Peninsula is, that gets you into Jalisco.
Thanks. Jim, let's start with that trip to St. Louis. Is that where you saw ink?
Yes. The first facility we toured was a facility, Inks, INX. And Inks makes 85% of the oil, or the ink that's used in the United States. They have several facilities around the United States. They also make all the food grade labels. And so if you look at any label that's on a food product, whether it's a label on a whiskey bottle or a ink on a soda can or the wrapping on frozen foods, that all contains 85% vegetable oil. And the reason for that is petroleum oils are toxic or can be toxic, and so the federal government requires that all labels have at least an 85% base of a vegetable oil. And most of those are soy-based oils.
Great. 85%, that's a huge market share.
Yes. Just one example they gave us was the red ink that Banquet uses for their frozen foods is 10 ton of ink a day.
Per day.
Per day.
Wow. After St. Louis, then you traveled to Mexico?
We also went out to the St. Louis airport and went through their facility where they blend 20% biodiesel blend with soy diesel. And they showed us the facilities for blending the oils and then the 73 pieces of equipment that they use, whether it's the fire trucks or the sweeps and things like that. And those all burn either compressed LP or a 20% blend of biodiesel. Then the next day, then we traveled to Mexico.
What did you see in Mexico?
Well, we actually saw many very interesting things. One of the places that we went to was a fish farm. In the state of Jalisco, there are 200 different fish farms, and we went to the one that was the largest one. It's also the most modern. They finish out 1 million fish a month just from the different facilities in Jalisco, and this one produces approximately half of the fish just in this one facility. They also have small tanks off to the side which contain other types of fish that are then exported to the United States and sold at a major U.S. retailer for people to use for their pet aquariums. Inside, the main fish that they feed is the tilapia fish, and with the tilapia, they serve it a meal that's actually about 75-80% soy meal, and then it's got a couple other things mixed with it, and that's compressed into a pellet that will then float. And since tilapia are surface feeders, they throw this meal onto the surface of the water, and then the tilapia will come up to the surface and eat the meal.
Well, before the show, you talked about the percentage of the soybean crop that goes to Mexico, and I think it was 17%?
17%. And one way that they told us to think about this is when you drive by a soybean field, count off six rows. That sixth row is going to Mexico. If you take a look at, it seems hard to believe, but over half of the soybeans that are produced in the United States are exported, with China being the major exporter and then Mexico being the second exporter. China imports about 50% or so of the soybeans that are exported out of the United States, and then Mexico imports about 17%.
Huge market, and that's obviously why you chose Mexico.
Correct.
The fish farm mm-hmm. was modern, clean?
Very modern. It had just been built in the past few years, and there were two different types of tanks they had. They had cement tanks that were probably about 10 or 12 feet in diameter, and in those they had nets around there, and that's where they kept the small fish. And the small fish were in the nets because there's an aerating system inside the tank, and they want to make sure that they don't suck the small fish into the aerators. And so they actually have the nets around the perimeter of the tank and then the small fish in there. And these are from hatchlings up to somewhere in the neighborhood of about a half a pound. They then take those fish out and then they put them into the larger tanks, which are probably close to the length of a football field and 20 to 30 feet across, and that's where the fish are finished up to where they weigh about 1 pound. They're then taken live to local markets in Guadalajara and the surrounding area and sold as live fish. Even though they're finishing 1,000 or 1 million fish a month, none of the fish are exported or processed. They're all sold live.
Interesting market niche.
Yes.
And you also saw some dairy facilities?
Yes. We went to a farm called Pro-Ann. And Pro-Ann is the largest farm in Mexico. Pro-Ann has 2,370 cows that they milk on a carousel system. They also have 21 million laying hens and 44,000 sows. We were allowed to go into the dairy facility. The dairy facility was very clean, very well maintained, as was the chicken facility. In the buildings that they have the chickens in, they have it divided into five buildings. And they have 21 million laying hens in the buildings, and they're stacked up in racks that are up to 8 high. And then they have systems for feeding and removing the eggs and the waste. And the eggs are taken to an area that's very sterile. They're all washed, they're canneled, and they're packaged. And they process about 19 million eggs a day, of which 18 million are used in Mexico, and 1 million are sent to South Africa.
Do you know the mode of transportation from Mexico to South Africa?
They didn't tell us that, but because of the requirement for freshness, I would assume that they're being shipped by cargo plane or something. I can't imagine that they can get them there quick enough in a ship. I don't know that for sure.
Jim, thinking about what you just told us about number of birds in a space and stacked 8 high, did anyone in this area mention things about regulations or issues with organizations that would maybe find that not acceptable?
I actually asked the person that, and they told me that they are heavily regulated by the federal government, the Mexican federal government, and they're inspected quite often. And for example, in the fish farm, they actually, the fish farm owners actually formed a co-op and they hired a veterinarian who then goes around and inspects the fish farms. The facility that had the chickens and the dairy and the hogs had full-time veterinarians and staff watching the animals at all times. I asked him about groups that were opposed to large animal facilities, and he said they have never had a problem with that because the people realize that they need to have facilities to produce the food to feed their population.
Interesting. In the dairy facility, I saw some of the pictures. It looked very clean and well run. Mm-hmm. Workers were well taken care of and paid?
The average person in the facilities was making about $17 a day. And while that may not seem like very much, that was considered a very good wage in their area, and the jobs were very competitive. And so in the dairy, it was very well clean, very clean, very well maintained. I asked the person if they were looking at the possibility of going to robotic milkers, and they were not looking at that at this time. In fact, they had never even heard of a robotic milker, and one of the people in our group told them that they could find that on YouTube if they wanted to see how a robotic milker worked. But because of the labor costs and things and the availability of help, they probably won't be going to something like that at this time.
Was that the farm that you were quoted in the Agri-News that had 2,300 cows?
Yes.
Wow, it looked like a very nice facility. What do they do for feed beyond soybean meal and protein, the forages?
Pro-Ann, which is the parent company of this, has a mill facility, and they import 210 unit trains from the United States every week. And that may be a mixture of soybean meal, DDGs, and corn, but they get these into there, and then they have an actual unloading facility, and every load that's unloaded has a probe taken, and the sample is taken to a facility where they burn it to look for calories and ash content, and then they also measure it for the different nutrients, and then they'll make adjustments in their feed as to how much corn or soybean meal or DDGs or minerals or things like that need to be added to the mix. When they make a batch of food for any of the animal facilities, they also keep a sample of it, and they take that sample and do a test on it again, and then they keep a small amount of that sample for 30 days in the event that any of the animals become ill or anything like that, they can go back and see that if it's a contaminant or something in the feed.
And in some of your pictures, it shows large bags being lifted in that feed mill. They come in on train from the United States?
Most of them are coming in by train. I'm not sure if they're from the United States, but most of the things coming in there are coming in on train or on truck.
And when the dairy animal needs hay and corn silage and forages, that's grown locally?
The hay and corn silage come locally, yes. And one of the things that they have down there is they, of course, have a much longer growing season than we have here. So you'll see corn that's maybe 120-day corn as opposed to the 100-day corn we have around here. But they will take and plant corn, and then maybe a week later plant corn again and plant corn, and so they have maybe six or eight different plantings that go through the year. So they've actually harvested the first while the second crop is growing, then they go in and harvest the second. And so it's not a one growing season on a plot, but it's spread out over longer periods.
Wonderful opportunity to spread the workload over more days.
Yes, and that was one of the things that we did see a couple corn planters, and the largest corn planter that I saw was four rows.
No hurry.
We'll wait
2 weeks and we'll plant some more.
Right.
Did you actually see some brand names of machinery?
Yes. Some of the pictures that I took down there were the brands that we see here. In one of the towns that we went through, there was a very nice John Deere dealership, very modern looking facility, and then right next to it was a Massey Ferguson, and then down the road, maybe about another mile, was an AGCO dealer. And scattered between them, if you look at the names of the seed companies, there was the Pioneer dealer, the DeKalb dealer, the Asgrow dealer, and they were all right in the same area as the implement dealers.
And of course, one of the questions our listeners are going to want to know, do those farmers have to pay the same amount for seed as our farmers in Minnesota?
Well, it's fairly comparable, yes.
Did you do any cost analysis on rate of returns, profit per pound of milk produced or bushel produced, anything like that? Did you get exposure to that?
We really didn't have much time or much dealing with that. As far as the outputs, when I talked with the farmers about how much milk they got per animal and things, for the most part, it sounded like they were getting about the same herd averages as what we were getting in this area. And the animals were very comparable as far as size and in appearance, too.
And one family owns both the dairy and the feed mill?
It's a corporation of a farm, yes, but it's all owned by one farm. And as is, they also have a box factory there where they make boxes to put the egg crates in, or the eggs in. And then they have a facility where they make egg cartons. Just for an example, they make about 190,000 boxes a day.
Wow. Sounds fairly integrated.
Yes, very much.
How does that compare to neighboring farms?
Well, a lot of what we saw around there were, in at least in this area, were larger farms, larger facilities. But then you would also see the small fields that would be maybe 10 acres, and they'd be on the side of a hill, and they would be, you know, they wouldn't be the nice square laid out acre or fields like we'd see around here. A lot of them were more odd shaped and things like that, but depending on where they could fit them in. And that area also is where they grow a lot of the agave plants, and agave is used for the making of tequila. And so you see a lot of, you don't see a lot of different crops in there, but other than corn and the agave plants.
Did you get any samples?
Oh, never drink tequila again.
You mentioned the president of the Mexico had something to say about junk food.
Yes. A couple days before we were there, he put in a ban on all junk food being sold to schools because they've seen a great increase in the rate of obesity. And so some of the health ministers had met with him and said, we have an obesity problem, we're seeing an increase in obesity and diabetes, and we need to do something about this. So the president banned junk food from the schools except for people that are juniors and seniors in high school. Otherwise, there can be no junk food anymore. And one of the things that I found very interesting was a few years ago, they were having trouble with malnutrition, especially in the indigenous people that were out in some of the smaller towns. So they found that most of their diet was a corn-based diet, and they were missing some amino acids. Mm-hmm. So they introduced soy products, and they've seen a great increase in the skill levels and things of the students in the schools. And the schools aren't large enough to have a cooking facility, so what they do is they've built the kitchens, and then they have the housewives come in and cook for their children. And that way they also were able to introduce the soy products into the local people's homes by saying, look, we're feeding this to your kids in school, they like it, it's good for them, and there's a little bit extra, so why don't you take it home and introduce it to your family? And so now they've seen where they've been able to take and bring a lot of these products into the local homes. And one of the things that I found was very interesting was in Mexico, they have over 100 food products that are available at the grocery stores that are soy-based. And they clearly mark the product as being a soy product because that's their real push to get people to go more for the soy-based products.
Jim, when those products are being introduced, that's being introduced by the United Soybean Board?
Yes, that they're working with offices down in Mexico, and so they've got staff down there that are working with the Department of Health to introduce soy products.
United Soybean Board is financed by checkoff dollars?
That's true, and what they do is if you take and sell a bushel of soybeans, 0.1% of the sale price, so, and that fluctuates a little bit because if beans are selling for $5 a bushel, they obviously get a lot less money than if they were selling for $10 a bushel. But they're bringing in, the United Soybean Board collects about $60 million a year. There's about $120 million collected nationwide. $60 million is kept in the state where the money comes from, and then the other $60 million goes to the United Soybean Board. And the United Soybean Board is 68 members from across the United States, and it's divided up into several small committees. I believe it was like 8 different committees or 10 different committees that looks at things like new product development, research and promotion, just different things like that, new uses and promotion and education. And what they'll do is they allocate the money and divide that money up for new products or programs such as the See for Yourself program.
So really, Jim, with the checkoff dollars, our United States soybean producers, farmers like yourself, are really financing their own advertising, promotion, research, correct?
Correct. The Texas A&M did a recent study on this to find out, for every dollar invested, what was the rate of return? And their calculations were that for every dollar that's invested in the soybean checkoff, that there are $6.60 return.
That's a nice return.
That's a nice return.
Let's keep doing that.
Yes.
When you were in Mexico, was there something that stands out as kind of a bonding or highlight kind of thing?
For me, probably one of the most touching moments for me was we went to a Walmart in Guadalajara, and I was told it's the largest one in the world, and I was also told it's the largest one in Mexico, so I'm not sure which is true. But we went in there to see where these products are being placed in the grocery store and if anyone's buying them. And as we were walking through, there was an elderly woman standing there holding two bottles of soy oil. And I took Spanish in high school, which was a few days ago, but I thought I would make an attempt to see if I could talk to her. So I walked up and introduced myself, and I told her that I raised soybeans in Minnesota and that I appreciated her purchasing the soy products because that's where the oil was coming from. And she became very excited and started yelling something, which I didn't know what it was, but it turned out it was her daughter's name. And so she brought her daughter over, and she then explained to her daughter that the oil that she was holding came from my farm, which may or may not be true.
Probably did.
Yeah. So then her daughter thanked me for producing this oil because her mother had some dietary issues and had to eat soy-based products. And so this was kind of a special moment. And then that particular day, we all happened to have on the same type of shirt for some group photos. And so I pointed out to different people that were standing around in the group and said, this is a producer from Michigan or Indiana or Illinois, and we all produce this oil. And it was a very special moment. They were very appreciative that we were producing this product for their market.
You were a hero.
Yeah. Doesn't happen very often. So,
more often than you think, Jim. Yeah. But if they're having an obesity and diabetes problem, and it looks like by the statistics it's up 13% in 5 years, and their government's getting involved, you probably are a hero. Look what you're doing for their diet and their health.
Yeah, and I thought it was very interesting how there's a very strong focus on getting soy products more and more into the market. Just a few years ago, they had 30 products, and now they have over 100 that are available for consumers.
And that's largely because of the work of soybean producers like yourself and United Soybean Board.
Yes.
If someone in our audience wants to find out more about United Soybean Board, is there a website or should they just Google it?
UnitedSoybeanBoard.org.
Yeah, and I hope they do that and learn more about it. Yeah. Anything else about that trip that just stands out as like, I didn't know that and I'm really glad I went on this trip?
Well, the thing that I was very impressed was we often think of how hard different groups work. And, you know, there's the people here work harder than anyone else and things. But when we went down there, we saw the pride that the people had in the jobs that they were doing and the willingness to share various things with us. It was very interesting for me when we would go into these facilities, how they would just open them up and bring us in and tell us how much they appreciated working with us, how much they like our product. One of the things they pointed out was that the products from the United States are much easier to get there because of the infrastructure. And then they also pointed out that a lot of times when they're getting products from South America or Central America, there's a lot more dust and dirt and things in there which they then have to remove from their products, and it adds more costs, and then there are animal health issues and stuff too. So it was very heartening to see that even though there are times when we have issues between the two countries, that we can work together.
Excellent points, Jim. Do you think NAFTA impacted the trade that happens with our soybeans?
According to the Soybean Board, yes, it had a positive impact. Mm-hmm. I don't really know enough about that impact to say, you know, to state exactly what that positive impact was, but they said that by opening up these trade agreements that we've been able to go into and help or establish markets, and then once the health officials are seeing how much better the soy product is than a lot of the items that they were able to grow or feeding their people, then they've welcomed that too. So it's had a very positive effect on it.
Thanks, Jim. We've got about 90 seconds left. For our audience especially, can you enumerate or name some products that are on our grocery shelves that have soy in them?
Well, one thing that if you look at things that say vegetable oil on it, even though a lot of people don't think of soy oil as being a vegetable oil, most oils that are cooking oils and things like that are going to be soy-based. Another thing, a lot of paints are now going to soy base, and a lot of the auto manufacturers are now making soy foam. Ford has over 2 million cars out that have foam seats in it that are a soy-based product. So there's more and more things all the time. And then, as I mentioned earlier, things like even the ink on the food containers is a soy-based product.
Excellent points, Jim. And I think salad dressings and in our baked goods,
yeah,
many, many things. Jim, thanks for taking the trip and sharing with us and going on the See for Yourself tour. And thanks to United Soybean Board for sponsoring it.
Yeah, and I hope everybody gets an opportunity to go on this program. It's an excellent RAND program.
And thanks for producing food. We value that.
Well, thank you for putting this show on, too.
And Jim Shekel, Dodge County Farm Bureau President and soybean corn producer from Dodge County, thanks again for sharing with us. And for more information, log on to ksmq.org and click on Farm Connections. There you can find past episodes and participate with the blogs. There you can submit your ideas. And don't forget to email the show at ksmq.org. And check us out on Facebook and Twitter. Tune in next time as we continue discussing impacts of ag on all of us. From everyone at Farm Connections, I'm Dan Hoffman. Thanks for joining us. See you again next week.